Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to this In Conversation session. My name is Sachin Chatte, and to the left and to my right are two gentlemen who need no introduction, so I'll not waste too much time in giving a lengthy introduction about who they are or what they are. And I'm hoping that during the course of this conversation, there are many things which will come out which will introduce you to them in more ways than one, in the sense that bringing out some facets about their life, about their views, which you have probably not heard before. To my left is a gentleman whose debut film made waves not only in India, but all around the world as well, Neeraj Ghaywan. And to my right is a filmmaker whose journey spans for more than 40 years and who's made films on social issues, on political issues, and much more, Mr. Prakash. I'll ask them questions, and towards the end of the session, we'll throw it open to the audience. Now, as Jean-Luc Godard said that, you know, a film should have a beginning, a middle, and an end, but not necessarily in that order. So I'll start with Neeraj, and I'll come to the middle straight away, because one thing that I was very fascinated, and I'm sure there are lots of people in India, thousands probably, who are engineers, architects, or lawyers, but who have a love for cinema, but have never been able to do anything beyond that love for cinema. Just they go to the theater and watch films. But Neeraj is an engineer by profession. He started off as an engineer. He did his MBA, and then he quit everything to make films. So how did that decision happen?
Yeah, so I was a corporate guy before, and I've done my engineering and MBA. And I was a typical, you know, tier one B school snob who would think that, you know, I have a big pay package and I have good money and I'm happy because I was getting paid well. And that's what I thought I was. And that the interest, that's how it was there. But the germ of it, I think, started when I was doing my MBA in Symbiosis Institute of Business Management. We had a specialized course on marketing communication. So they had a film school class where they said that a dean from FTI would come and it would take one afternoon session and he would talk about cinema. So before that, it was just, you know, watching Westerns with my flatmate. That was the kind of understanding I had with cinema. It was just fun and, you know, entertainment. And when I, so this lecturer, he came in and he talked about first film of Satyajit Ray, and each visual was explained and he spoke in length about what it means and what doesn't mean. And that time I actually thought about, you know, how these films really, I mean, started seeing cinema as an art form more than mere entertainment. And also way back as I grew up, I mean, middle class, upper middle class household, you know, educated middle class from smaller towns, that's the story of all of our lives. So my parents and my sisters, they all would watch a lot of, you know, Shyam Benegal and those kind of films that used to come on Doordarshan. So it's not like I was born interested in these kind of films. It's just that I happened to be conditioned into it because I'd end up watching all these films. Now I comprehend their meaning and everything now. And like that, the journey went about and I was working and I was getting paid well. And I really thought I was happy because I was, you know, I could afford, you know, the most expensive whiskey for all my friends. And I thought that is the definition of being successful or happy. And, but then this thing about cinema was way too much inside of me. Then I'd met Anurag once because he's called a couple of bloggers and he used to tell me that you should write more. And he said, I really like the way you write. Then I said, okay, I'll do film marketing because I'll also get the pay package that I'm used to and also marketing film, say I'll be related. So this is best of both worlds, you know, that I'm used to. So I used to really write every day to UT Sport, but I think that time they were making these kind of films that were really good and I wanted to be part of that film thing. And but I could never get a response. I used to write to Vikas Bal, who was the CEO of UT time. Never got a response. And then somehow Anurag was doing this thing for short films with UTV New Media, as a new company that started. And they were looking for people who would, you know, it was a startup. So I was from the web industry, I was a brand manager for a lot of dot-coms and product manager. So I thought, why not? I mean, I'll just, because it just three floors down four floors above is UTV Productions. So I'd at least go close, because I used to literally, I'm not kidding, literally used to dream about being in Bombay every day. Like every day I used to dream about it. And I thought, why not? I mean, this is my chance. I mean, this, because there was a hiring freeze across the industry because there weren't any jobs. So I thought I'll go there. So I took a pay cut and I took a grade cut. And I thought I'll join there. And I worked for 2 months. So my first job was to market johnabraham.com. And the campaign's name was Get in Bed with John. And it was a very, very difficult campaign to crack because A, I came from a B2B world, business to business, and I'm here directly consumer interaction. And I had no idea about how this marketing world functions. And everything had to raise money from the market. Basically, you go to the radio and say that we'll put you on TV. We go to a TV, you say that you'll put you on print. So that's how you raise market from the money from the market. And I went about, but nobody would buy the thing, obviously. And that first time I tasted failure, because I've been a consistently good performer in my corporate life. And I felt that that's when it really sunk in, that what am I doing here? And because I was not used to being to failure, I felt that this is my undoing. And, there's something wrong, tell me about it. And he said, I told him that, you know, I don't know what I'm doing, this is not happening. So he said, tu itna wo kyun kar raha hai, tu shortcut kyun dhoond raha hai ki tu aa ja mere saath. So I said, Anurag, it's nice of you to say it, because you know so many people want to work with you, and you are asking me, I'm feeling embarrassed, but I don't know if I have it in me. So he said, how will you know if you don't do it? And that kind of really struck a chord inside of me, and I was like thinking about it. I was in office actually late night. I finished the call, I came back to my desk. I immediately typed out my resignation. I wrote it to Ronnie, everybody, marked it, everyone, and then it hit. Just resign.
So the resignation also happened in a very filmy style.
Yeah, there's more to it. There's the, like you say, in the middle, there's the conflict arises now. My parents had set me up for a marriage alliance that day. So they said, go and jaake usse mil lo. So my dad calls me just then and says, ki tu mil liye? Kisse mil liye? Are wo tumhe bola tha, toh then it's like, nahi, main mila nahi. And I'm not getting married. I just quit my job. I'm going to join films. There was 5 minutes of silence, and then there was loud screaming from both my parents. And then they didn't speak to me for about 7 months. So I've literally felt orphaned, because you know, you took such a big decision of your life and there's nobody around. So Anurag came back, and then that's how, sorry it took a long time to explain this.
No, that was a very solid beginning. I believe they didn't speak to you for 7 months, but at some point then later when Masaan became successful, your dad threw a grand party.
Yeah.
We'll come to that. But Prakashji, was your start also so dramatic? You went to FTII, you studied filmmaking there for some time. So how did your start start?
Well, I don't know if it has really begun as yet. Because, I mean, we all have stories, and I probably have mine. I actually ran away from college. I hated studying. I Delhi University doing physics honors because I thought it was easy. And I didn't complete my first semester. I went back home, and I'm from Bihar, you know. Upper caste, Brahmin family. Having gone to a public school. So it is assumed that, you know, I will compete at the UPSC and become an IAS or IPS or IFS, because they manufacture, you know, civil service servants in Bihar. That's the mindset. And I don't know why, I still sometimes try and find out what was the reason that I didn't want to get into that grind, and I just wanted to, you know, do something different. And I really didn't have any talent that I could, you know, say that this is what I want to do. apart from the fact that I used to sketch and maybe make some very ordinary paintings and try my hand at clay modeling or wax modeling. But the university was probably too much for me, and I just wanted to run away from the quantum physics chapters. And I told my parents, especially my father, who was a farmer, that I was going away, and I was going away to Mumbai. Now, sometimes I try and question myself, why did I go to Mumbai? I mean, I wanted to join an art school. I could have gone to Delhi, I could have gone to Baroda, I could have gone to Kolkata. But somehow or the other, I ended up in Mumbai, and I didn't have any money because my father gave up on me, and my mom wanted to give some money to me, and I said, look, I mean, this is now my journey, and I don't want you guys to pay for something which you don't want me to do. So I literally had no money. I just had 300 rupees with me, and I bought a ticket and I came to Mumbai. And I never ever had dreamt of, you know, making movies or being in films. And was actually trying to get into the JJ School of Arts. The semester had begun, and I had to wait for a few months. I did all kinds of jobs to support myself. I used to initially met somebody on the train when I was coming in. He was a contractor, labor contractor, so he gave me a place to kind of sleep in his, you know, house, and I used to write accounts for him at his construction sites. I used to go to Kalba Devi and teach, you know, speaking English to the Gujarati businessmen out there. They had these coaching classes. And do all kinds of jobs to somehow support myself. And it was quite accidental that I met someone who lived in the same building, who was an art director. Now, I didn't know what an art director is, except that, you know, when he told me that he did the glass work for that famous song of Mughal Azam, Pyar Kiya Toh Darna Kya, that I knew. And the name of the gentleman was Aga Jani. He was, you know, a very classic art director. So one day, on a Sunday, he was, you know, going somewhere. And I said, where are you going? And he said, I'm going to meet my director, Chand Saab, who is shooting in Juhu. So I said, oh, you know, we're going to a film shoot, and he said yes. And that was the first time ever that I tagged along with him. I said, can I come with you? And we went together, and in Juhu there was just this one hotel at that time, Sun and Sand. Juhu was, you know, quite beautiful then. Nothing existed apart from, you know, a few buildings and this hotel. And I went to Sun and Sand, and while he spoke to the director, Chand Saab, who was doing a film called Dharma, Naveen Nischal, Rekha, Pran Sahab, they're all there in that film, and that song was being shot. Raj ko Raj rehne do isharon mein. That was the song which was being shot. And something happened. I stood there in a corner from almost 9 in the morning up to 9 in the night. I didn't move because I thought if I moved and somebody noticed then they'll throw me out of the set. And I watched the whole day, the film shoot. The movements, the dresses being carried in, you know, on hangers, the trolleys being laid, the lights being done, the glass being cut, you know, the song being picturized. And by evening, I was completely transformed. I said, this is it. This is what I want to do in my life. And that's how it happened.
It's very interesting because I see lots of youngsters here and many film students as well. So I'm sure these stories will go a long way in inspiring many of y'all. Your fascination was for feature films, but yet you started by making documentaries. So was it the background of Bihar where things are always politically motivated or politically charged and socially, it's more of a happening place in that sense? Was that the reason why you started with documentaries?
No. It was just purely survival, actually. You know, I mean, people think even today that, you know, I make socio-political cinema with message and I probably, you know, have something up my sleeves to say or to... It's nothing like that. I just try to tell a story. You know, I am no flag bearer. I don't think I want to change the society. The society is the way it is, you know, and it just gives me stories, you know, and I just find characters who are interesting and try and put them in my movies. You know, I'm just a simple storyteller, a filmmaker, and it does kind of like, you know, I mean, the whole process takes a lot because the idea is to make a movie which will be popular, which will be commercial, which people will want to see and pay for it. And I'm far from being, you know, having any kind of ambition to be, you know, great filmmakers like Satyajit Ray or Godard or things like that who evolved different languages of cinema. Cinema for me is a means of communication. Simple. I have no desire to create a new language of cinema. I have no illusion about that. I primarily use the whole form of cinema to say. That's why, I mean, my visuals or my style, you know, it's I just keep it as simple as, you know, as it can be. And I to answer your question, you know, to cut a long story short, I mean, I became Chand Saab's assistant. I went back the next morning to him, took Aga Jani with me, and said, please introduce me, I want to become a film director. And he introduced me, and I was the 13th assistant, because there were 12 already. Deva was his chief assistant at that point of time. And during the course of the day, I asked Deva how many years had he been the chief assistant. He said, about 11, 12 years. I said, my God, I mean, I don't want to wait that long, you know, to become a chief assistant, and then God knows when I'll be a director. So 4 days that the shooting was happening at Sun and Sand, I was there. I mean, hardly an assistant, probably like bring a glass of water or tea or move a chair or something like that. And then I took a train, went to Pune, and found out everything about the Film and Television Institute. The only course that I was qualified for, because I was not a graduate, was film editing. Because then, film editing, you could just be an intermediate. We used to have intermediate then, you know, like 10 plus 2 plus 1 year of college. No, Barmi plus 1, which I didn't have, you know. So I came back, I took admission at KC College, and I took a job in a restaurant. So I used to work and go to college at the same time. Did that for a year, collected some money, and got a certificate, and finally went to the institute. Unfortunately, because I was in the same batch as Nasiruddin Shah or Om Puris and these actors who were kind of like, you know, great big actors, and they had lots of problems with Girish Karnad, who was the director then, and eventually the institute within a year, you know, was shut down because there was a strike, and we were all kind of like, you know, sent away from the hostel. So I couldn't even complete my course at Film Institute, as luck would have it. So we all came back to Mumbai. We had no place to live, no money to eat. So I started looking for work, and I started writing scripts. But 1 year at the Film Institute was amazing. 1 year of film editing, where, you know, everything was available. And I edited a documentary which was made by Ketan Mehta. I assisted him in production and ended up editing that film. And got enough hang of kind of like, you know, basic techniques. So I wasn't really qualified to be making feature films, but I started trying my hand. And as luck would have it, I got a documentary. My very first feature documentary that I made was in Goa. I was able to convince the chief minister of Goa then, Shashikala Kakodkar, used to be the chief minister. Yes, I know. I saw that. To do a film on tourism in Goa, festivals of Goa, and Under the Blue was the documentary which is the first film which was censored in my name. And the year was 1975. Sorry? No.
No, that was much later.
Under Tamil was made in 1984. Much later. So I started, like, I mean, it was basically survival. Get a documentary, then films division, government departments, some sponsors. Those days it was not very difficult to get documentaries. Then I traveled. I traveled a lot in Europe and worked in Germany for some time, France and England. I was in doing documentary in UK way back in 79, 80, 81, and I came back in 81 after having done about, you know, 15, 16 documentaries. Then I started looking for, you know, a feature film or story.
So it was a long journey from the time you made the first documentary till you made Damul and Hip Hop.
6 years, almost 6 years.
6, 7 years. Mm. So were you consciously sticking to documentaries, or you had an ambition to make a film but it was not happening?
I really didn't think about it like that, you know. It just used to go, you know, from one day to the other, and whatever kind of like came my way. The documentary which I made after I came back from London was a documentary on Bihar Sharif Hindu-Muslim riots, 1981, which also won my first President's Award, National Award for the first documentary. And in that documentary, I had used a poem written by a gentleman called Shaiwal from Gaya in Bihar. I read that poem in Dharmyug, Hindi,
good old
magazine, and I got in touch with Shaiwal, and then I read some of his stories, and there was a story called Kala Sutra. I immediately connected with that story because it was a story about a feudal landlord and serf and the relationship and the bonded labor, etc. Because I had, as a child, seen all that back in my village, and I thought that there was a huge possibility there. So that was the first film I wrote, Damul. But as, you know, chance or something of that sort happened, I ended up, while I had submitted this script to NFDC, I ended up doing Hippie Purre as my first film, yeah.
Welcome to Neeraj. You didn't formally go to a film school. So did at any point that act as a hindrance in your career, or just working as an assistant on those 2-3 films gave you the confidence that you can make your own film at that point?
Actually, yes and no, because I believe that film school really gives you a lot of technical edge, which is why you see most technicians are from film schools. And I really liked it because I've had this penchant for academia so much, so I thought that a formal science would really bring me up to the speed. But I also say no, because I've also seen the side of how too much of knowledge would also become detrimental to your career, in the sense that, see, this is what happened when I was about to make Masaan. There's a gentleman from FTI whose father was also the dean of FTI. He had seen my first short film called Shore, and he sought me out. And I'd known him before, social media through. Like, I don't know, there's a term called that. So we knew him from blogging. So he said, there's a reason why I sought you out. And I said, he took me out for lunch. And he said, he went on about that short film. He said, you know, I've also shown it to my father. If my father agrees, and, you know, it's a great short film for you. For the kind of time that you spent in industry, and suddenly you made this. Then he said very important words to me. He said, passion is finite. And then it hit me, like, it is so true. Because we, people from the industry or people aspiring to be in, we tend to think that passion is, we are going to be passionate all through forever. It is not going to be. Everything fades. True love fades. First love fades. Everything fades. So passion also dissipates over time. So while you're at it, make the most of it. So I had thoughts of, you know, like way back when I started with Anurag, I said, do you want me to go to, I thought I'll go to Tish. Then I looked at the fees. Then I said, okay, not happening. Then I wanted to go to FTI. I thought about it. But then I continued with it. So then, but I saw some of my friends who went about doing this. And then I realized that there is no, so this person who told me this line, he said that, you know, you'll lose your original thought or your original thinking. Because right now what you have is truly yours. It's not kind of colored by Anurag's thoughts. Because it happens inadvertently when you assist someone so much. So much of it goes into your unconscious. So it wasn't there. So he said, you'll get, try to creep that. So I feel that kind of gets... Because you read up so much about so many of the masters and you grow up in so much of awe of them, that it's very difficult to see beyond a science that exists now. Like, for instance, so much contemporary filmmakers have abandoned every kind of filmmaking thought. You know, the three-act structure is no more holding true. Michel Haneke has completely changed so many editing patterns. He cuts to black. There are so many changes happening, but in academia, what happens is you're still stuck with how Tarkovsky made those beautiful frames, and, you know, you're always stuck with Barjanov or those filmmakers. But I thought that, you know, more contemporary knowledge. And what also happens is that once you, of course, there is theory and practice, the same funda applies here. Because I learned so much faster. Of course, I'm not denying that technical knowledge is something that I lack. And there is a reason why I also deliberately don't want to get to learn so much of technology. But I think it helped me a lot in terms of getting practical understanding, because even if you read up a lot, unless you be on set, you wouldn't ever understand the nuances of what goes about on a set. Like, what are the dynamics? Like, simple things like, how do you communicate to your producer? How do you go pitching about? You know, how do you understand the crew size? Like, if you realize that if you're making this film, you would know how many days it will take to shoot. You would know how much budget to put in. There's so many, like, you know, filmmaking, that there's a thing called scheduling that we do for our number of days. Trust me, it's the most difficult operations problem in math to crack at it, because it's very, very difficult. The same that maybe many statisticians also get into, that kind of tough thing it is. So I really feel that I'd still wish to have some academic course, but I'm really happy that I didn't, because it really helped me in bringing practical knowledge and also having retained my original thinking.
I think we've covered the journey a fair bit now. I would like your views on certain issues. In India, we love...
Oh, sorry, I just want to know from sir. I want to know your journey from Damol. How did it happen? I'm curious to know. Sorry.
No, I mean, it's a very conscious kind of, like, I sought this story. Kalasutra. And I asked Shewal if he would let me make a, you know, a screenplay and film on it. He was very happy. He collaborated with me on this screenplay. I submitted the screenplay to National Film Development Corporation. Those were the golden days, the 80s, early 80s, when National Film Development Corporation was hugely functional, and all of us together, like Saeed Mirza, Ketan, Kundan, Vinod, me, and a whole lot of filmmakers from Bengal, Gautam, Buddhadev, Adur from Kerala, we were all making films together with the help of National Film Development Corporation. I did two films with them, Damul and Parinati, and both the films remain my favorite films. It was only post the open market economy, when National Film Development Corporation was almost shut and sort of like, you know, thrown out open in the market to fend for itself. And you'll be happy to know, or sorry to know, that the NFDC had to, you know, import films from Hong Kong, the Kung Fu films and the God knows what films, to distribute and earn money to pay a salary to its staff, you know, in the... I mean, till today, the NFDC has not gotten back into its mode of, like, you know, funding films, which is such a pity, because there are so many brilliant new filmmakers who would be able to make movies. And now that good kind of, like, you know, avenues for exhibition, and Neeraj would have probably found it much easier to do his Masaan through NFDC if NFDC was operational. Anyway, so that's how Damul happened. I submitted it to the NFDC and it got approved. I was granted a loan of 8 lakhs rupees at that point of time. And
was it a princely sum back then?
Yes, yes. I mean, I completed the film in 10 lakhs. We shot the film over 24 days, and we did a lot of rehearsals and a lot of pre-production and planning, and we didn't go over budget or didn't overshoot. And it was difficult to return the money, because no distributor would take the film for releasing in cinemas. It was only when the film got the National Film Award, National Award for the Best Feature Film, that I was able to twist the arm of the Information Broadcasting Ministry and said, look, and told them that, you know, I mean, find an avenue or a window. And that's how the whole premiering the film on a Sunday, National Award winning films on Sunday, and on the Doordarshan started. And for one show, I charged them 8 lakhs rupees and the whole loan was returned. That's how it began.
Wish it was here now available. There's no such avenue now.
Sadly. There still is. They still pay 8 lakhs, which is nothing.
No, but then 8 lakhs plus also, I mean, the kind of radical films that we make, they're all branded adult, and then you don't get satellite at all. So
you don't get satellite. Yes, that's a pity. I mean, I just have produced a film called Lipstick Under My Burkha. Which
talk
is
us about that, because it got
which is doing the kind of film festival circuits which your film did right now, and is winning awards all over. But I know how difficult it's going to get a certificate for that film and release that film. It's really going to be tough.
Just one more question: you have transcended all these boundaries, right from making documentaries to If I Make All Them. Art films like Damul or Hippe Pure, and then highly successful commercial films like Gangajal, Aparan, and the rest. So was there a conscious decision on your part that you didn't want to be typecast as a particular kind of filmmaker, or was the journey natural?
Nee, again, you know, the story is not like that. I would make any film that I can possibly do. I mean, what would you do? Suddenly we are all out of work, because I wrote a script after Damul and Parinati. I wanted to make Mrityudand. Mrityudand was reflection on, you know, two extremely potent social changes which happened almost at the same time: open market economy and Mandal Commission. early 90s. And its impact on our basic structure of, you know, rural society. And I met these characters when I was in Bihar, and I saw things that the way they were happening, and I really was able to work out that story, Mrityudand. Now, Mrityudand, I came to Mumbai to do that film, and Pallavi Joshi was cast already. I had signed her up. And I was trying to make that film in a small budget, but I realized that I couldn't make that film no matter what, you know, within the 8 lakhs or 10 lakhs which the NFDC would, you know, probably try and give it to me. That film would cost me at least 40 lakhs, and there was no way I could release that film or recover the money. So I kept on trying, and as luck would have it, again, one day I happened to meet Subhash Ghai, just like that. And people knew me because of the National Award, and he just like asked me, "Kya, what's happening?" You know, and I said, "I've got this script, and I don't know how to go about it, and I'm just trying to figure out." So he briefly heard the story. I said, "It's a fantastic story. You know, you should have somebody like Madhuri Dixit working in this film. Then you will be able to get the money." And I said, "Yeah, you think she will understand this kind of story and want to do it?" I said, "Yeah, try." So he set up my meeting with Madhuri Dixit. And when I went to meet Madhuri Dixit, she was actually shooting that song from Khalna, actually, Ke Piche Kya Hai, in Filmalaya studio. So she would come back, you know, in between the shots, and I would narrate the story to her. It took me about 3 or 4 hours to narrate that story. And by the end of it, she was like completely bowled over. I said, "Yes, I'm doing this film." So that's how, you know, the transition to the commercial market. Because when I realized I can't make films, and you can see it, that all of us, Saeed Mirza or Kundan or, you know, Ketan, we all faced that problem, and we all either had to kind of like, you know, make films which were friendly to the market. So here I had to rewrite that whole script from market's point of view. Mrityudand, that was the challenge. The same scenes, and I have the scripts, like, you know, written very honestly as it would happen, and then written very dramatically. You know, each line, like, you know, the line where, you know, Madhuri tells Ayub that, you know, and he tells her after he pulls her hair, says that, "Biwi hai, hamara shohar banne ki koshish mat kijiye." And she says, "Aukaat ko taakat ka taraju mein tolne ka koshish mat kijiye. Pati hai hamare ya parmeshwar banne ki bhool mat kijiye." Now, this is not a dialogue from Damul or Parinati. I would have never written this dialogue, but I wrote it. Because, you know, the grammar of commercial cinema. And this reminds me of a lovely story which I must tell you. When Damul eventually was telecast on Doordarshan, I don't know if you remember the telecast. Now, Damul was my film, it had won the National Award, and I was suddenly like, you know, being kind of like, you know, sort of like talked about. And I found premiere on Doordarshan, and it was well publicized, the premiere on Doordarshan. So I was married to Deepthi then, and we lived in Warsaw, and we had a lovely bhai who was very, very supportive of the work that I used to do. And bhai had called, like, you know, told all her family members that aaj saab ki film aane wali hai TV pe. So her whole family had come, and some of my friends, and we were, like, you know, we were having snacks and seeing Damul was like, Damul came on, you know, TV, and it was kind of like, you know, darkish film, both in content and style. So we all celebrated it, me and my friends, and Deepthi and her friends, and she saw the whole film. And after, you know, the film got over, she got up quietly and she went to the kitchen and she started doing our dinner or things like that. And at the end of it, I noticed that she had turned quiet, and I sort of like cornered her and said, "Kya baat hai? Tumko film achhi nahi lagi kya?" "Nahi, achhi thi." "To aisa kyun chup hai?" "Nahi, achha banaya film, lekin achha laga. But next time banana to film banana." So that didn't fall in her concept of, you know, a movie. Or so that's how the commercial cinema is all about. Like, I mean, I then began the experiment of trying to make, you know, tell my stories in the language which will be understood, which they will find interesting. So the dialogues, the scenes, the mounting of the scene, the opening of the scene, the structure of a script, it all changed. A lot of people, a lot of my friends and critics said that I've sold myself to the commercial world. They keep on saying that, you know, yeah, the Damul aur Parinati banane ke baad Prakash Shah bilkul matlab kachra ho gaya, band, kharab ho gaya. Kya bolenge unko? Aap film banao, koshish karo banane ki. Pata chalega.
I remember when Damul came on TV, was it 85? Any other questions? Yes, please.
Last question from me before I pass the mic. Again to Prakash, sir. Sir, you had nicely taken the heads of a director, writer, editor, producer, everything nicely. What delayed this hit of an actor, and you know, what was your immediate inspiration before acting in Jai Gangajal?
My immediate inspiration was Neeraj. He hasn't decided about his next film. I'm going to send my portfolio to him.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm a filmmaking student from Pune. I wanted to know when you were writing Masaan. So basically, I've found a lot of connect in the audio, like the songs and the lyrics. So while writing, how do you connect the visual and the audio?
You're purely talking about the songs, right?
Yeah, I mean, there are a few visuals while the background also connects a lot. So how while scripting or the screenplay, how do you make it the audio visual connect?
Are you talking about the integration of the song in the film?
Yeah, I mean, in the songs basically, but yeah, in the whole movie also, it
you're talking about the visual language basically, yes, of the film.
The audio and the visual.
Fundamentally, see, like I was telling a while back that I don't get into a lot of technical. Like I get scared of when DP start talking technology. Like when they say, "Yahan se ek stop, do stop," I blank out. In fact, me being such a geek, I'm forcibly not getting into it. Because the thing is, when you get into that, then you fuck. Because I'm a purely a narrative guy. I love narrative styles. And I don't want to be seen like extremely visual filmmaker. That's, in fact, I kind of align with how Prakash ji is also, in the sense that, you know, he's core is storytelling. That's what I want to be. So I never bother to understand these things forcibly. That's saying I don't want to know. Because I only want to look at the performance. Then with Masaan, what asked the visual writing, if you would say, it was more trying to undo in the sense that how to be staying with the character so much. So my DP actually came up with a very interesting thought. Avinash Arun, he had made this film called Killa, if you'd know. So he said that let's shoot, there's this aspect ratio thingy. So 16:9 is the general format. Okay, he said let's shoot in 1:85. What happens in 16:9 is that you compose your frames so much so that you're probably at the edge, the character is at the edge, and you see the landscape behind. So that's a more visual storytelling. But in Masaan, we deliberately chose 1:85 because we thought it's more about the people and less about the place. So what you do is, when you do 1:85, you have more leg room of height. So you see the character more, you lose the background. So that was the style that we adopted. And also on set, there was no conscious effort to actually beautify things. If you're, for example, the question that you asked, there is one example is that when Vicky's character, Deepak, he is sitting by the Gangaji and he's crying, it naturally occurred to him. A train passed by and he naturally said, "Tu kisi rail se guzarti hai." So that was, you know, serendipitous in the sense that he came up with it and we said, let's keep it like that. And so many times it has happened. So, you know, it was never visual serving narrative. It was never that a visual overpowering the narrative. That was a clear thing that me and Avinash had. And I would never get into like, mujhe sirf itna chahiye, aisa chahiye, mujhe 50 chahiye, 60 chahiye, that's all. I would never get into light, whatever, he would just do it.
That was like, thank you. Last question that, do you think of the sound also while writing or you just finish up ending?
Yeah, because I, like I said, I'm a geek, so I have this thing, like I spent 1.5 years of post-production in gangs and I know those 7 months of sound that I did and that's why I get too much into it. So sound is an element because I know that there's going to be the chitaka sound, the sound of this and the landscape and the way it should sound. I didn't want the typical sounds of Banaras which could be like, you know, galiyon mein dikhate hain, ye dikhate hain. So try to get it more modern, earthy, and we mix this film in Paris actually because it's Indo-French production, so we mix the film in Paris. I remember this one particular episode of sound I want to tell you is we went back because I said I'm not going to do Foley for the bodies burning and all. I didn't want Foley. I wanted actual sounds. So me and my sound designer went to Banaras and we said we'll do recordings. We had a small Zoom camera, Zoom mic. And as soon as he was also from UP, but he's never seen Banaras. So he got there and he was like, shell-shocked because we went to Manikarnika Ghat where some 40-50 bodies are burning at any given time. And it's very scary to be at that place. So we went there and he was totally like gone because there was this aarti going on. You know that underground there is a mandir. So by the way, on Masan, sorry I'm taking too much time, but on Masan, the locals wanted me to do 3-4 pujas. So one of the pujas involved that I had to give do puja to Manikarnika Ghat, where the things that I have to chadao was one ganja, there was alcohol, afim, bhang, yeah, bhang, and 5 elements. Like they do panchamrit, there's a different panchamrit for Manikarnika. And you have to do, and you go underground, there are black-robed sadhus, not the bhagwa ones. You have to go underground, it was scary to do that puja. I came out, that dangal started being, and this guy got really scared. So I took his Zoom mic, and I recorded it. I bought this sling wala bag, and I went about like a tourist. And I hit the, because you can't shoot there for nothing. You can't even record sound. So I squatted down to record. Here there's a leg melting right on my ear, and here there's a boy melting. I'm sitting there and recording sound. So that kind of sound design has happened.
Thanks a lot, thank you.
Yes, one question, last question.
Hello sir, I am Shantosh Shah from Lucknow. I Prakash sahab se janna chahta tha. Sir, Hindi filmon ki jo baat hoti hai, lekin conversation ya baatcheet mein Hindi bolne se itna parhej kyun kiya jata hai? Even industry mein, script mein bhi, Roman mein hi pura kaam hota hai. Aisa kyun hai?
But aisa hai to kya bura hai? भाषा का क्या अर्थ है कम्युनिकेट करना हम जिस तरह से बोल के करें जिस तरह से लिख के करें जब तक आप तक पहुंच जाती है मेरी बात मुझे तो कोई दिक्कत नहीं लगती उसमें
यस वन लास्ट
सी अबाउट इट दिस इज समथिंग दैट मैं इस चीज से बहुत जूझ रहा हूं और मैं बहुत इस चीज को सवाल करता हूं कि जैसे मैंने बहुत बार देखा है कि प्रोडक्शन हाउस में अगर आपने आपको अंग्रेजी ठीक से नहीं आती आप टूटी फूटी अंग्रेजी बोलते हो तो आपको चांस नहीं मिलता कि आपको फिर स्क्रिप्ट बताएं आपकी अगर अंग्रेजी कमज़ोर है तो फिर आप जैसा स्क्रिप्ट लिखते हैं तो वो पढ़ते नहीं हैं लोग सो दिस आई फील इज डेफिनेटली रॉन्ग बिकॉज अगर आप हिंदी फिल्में बना रहे हैं तो वाई नॉट राइट योर एक्शन योर डायलॉग एवरीथिंग इन हिंदी एंड देर शुड बी आई रियली सपोर्ट दैट थिंग एंड आई hate the arrogance that comes from a lot of the students that I've seen. कि अगर बहुत suave English बात करते हैं, बहुत polished हैं, so yeah, it's a good filmmaker, good stuff, ये वो. But why not the same thing for somebody who's as talented, in fact, more than talented? And I've seen it so many times. This is something that I keep crusading about a lot. कि अगर कुछ assistants हैं, जो गांव-वांव से आए हैं, लेकिन इतने talented हैं, but not these people who speak such good English, but they still can't bring in that kind of magic that these people bring. So, sorry, I randomly butted.
Oh, that's a very important point at the same time. Yes, one last question.
Sir, my name is Krishna Kumar, and I'm a FTI student who is screenplay writing. So, my question is screenplay. Sir, the setting, the story setting, the system, which is the
story?
A story setting.
Where is it?
मतलब इस स्टोरी में जो प्लेस का जो सेट सेट डिजाइनिंग करते हैं
सेटिंग
हाँ सेटिंग हाँ थोड़ा इंग्लिश
नहीं नहीं कोई बात नहीं
समझ गया हाँ
तो आप दोनों सही है जिस तरह से आप दोनों चूज करते हैं प्लेस को या स्टोरी में जिस तरह से वो प्लेस आ जाता है निखर के वो चीज कैसे आए ये चीज मेरा पूछना है स्टोरी में कैसे आए वो चीज क्यों प्लेस अच्छे से निखर के आया और उस प्लेस का जो एक अपना फिलॉसफी होती है कि वो प्लेस की अपनी निकल कर आए स्टोरी में ये चीज
कैसे निकल कर आए ये तो किसी बच्चे को भी कहानी कहेंगे तो दो तीन चीजें तो बहुत बेसिक होती है ना जगह समय और कैरेक्टर हम एक नानी बच्चे को भी कहानी कहती है तो कहती है कि बहुत दिन पहले एक सोने के देश में एक ऐसा राजा था एक लाइन में उसने तीनों चीजें बखान कर दी तो आप भी जब एज स्क्रीन प्ले राइटर कोई भी चीज लिखते हो या मैं भी जब लिखता हूं तो वो हर चीज घटती है होता है तो कहीं ना कहीं होता होगा बेडरूम में होता होगा बरामदे में होता होगा लॉन में होता होगा बाजार में होता होगा रेगिस्तान में होता होगा कब्रिस्तान में होता होगा कहीं ना कहीं तो होता होगा तो वो कल्पना तो आप कर सकते हैं या वो वास्तविकता भी आप महसूस कर सकते हैं उसी तरह से पात्रों की वास्तविकता महसूस कर सकते हैं और हमेशा जब भी कोई चीज होती है तो सुबह होगा या दोपहर होगी या शाम होगी या रात होगी वक्त भी महसूस करते हैं क्योंकि मैं तो जब कोई सीन लिखता हूं कोई दृश्य लिखता हूं तो इन सारी चीजों के साथ में टेम्परेचर क्या होगा क्या वक्त क्या होगा और ये जो बात कर रहे थे कि एम्बियंस जो है वो किस तरह का होगा कि आवाज़ें किस तरह की आ रही हैं पड़ोस किस तरह का है दूर में क्या चीज़ें अवस्थित हैं वो सारा माहौल सामने आ जाता है महसूस करने लगता है कि स्क्रीन प्ले राइटर के पास ये क्षमता तो होनी ही चाहिए कि आप इन सारी चीज़ों को महसूस करें क्योंकि इन सारी चीज़ों का प्रत्यक्ष या परोक्ष प्रभाव आपके पात्रों पर आपके दृश्य पर और आपके लेखन पर आपकी फिलॉसफी पर आपके शब्दों पर उस वक्त पड़ेगा ही पड़ेगा तो इसमें कोई चाहे आप वास्तविकता से लें या कल्पनाशीलता से लें
नहीं जैसे हम लोगों को अभी वर्क चल रहा है तो 4 पेजर में हम लोग अभी 4 पेजर 8 पेजर इस तरह चलता है प्रोसेस में तो उसमें मेरे प्रॉब्लम यही हो रहा था स्टोरी सेटिंग मतलब प्लेस का जो एक आता है कि जैसे इलाहाबाद मैंने सेटिंग रखी है तो उसका जो प्लेस का जो अपना निकर कर आना चाहिए वो चीज मेरे से हो नहीं रहा था तो मैं इसलिए वो चीज
आप जाएं वो उस चीज को जगह पे बैठे जैसे हम आप यहाँ बात कर रहे हैं इस वक्त इस कमरे के अंदर में क्या आवाजें आ रही है वो एयर कंडीशनर की आवाज थोड़ी आ रही है थोड़ी फर्नीचर के हिलने कभी आवाज़ आ जाती है कभी कपड़े के रसल की आवाज़ आ जाती है वो सारी चीज़ों को महसूस आप अगर आप अवेयर हैं तो आप महसूस करते हैं उसी तरह से आप स्क्रीन पे राइटर की तरह आप महसूस करेंगे उन चीज़ों को आप
महसूस ना शुरू करें।
आप कहाँ से हैं?
मैं तो हूँ इलाहाबाद से।
इलाहाबाद से? इलाहाबाद से होकर आप इलाहाबाद नहीं सोच पा रहे हैं, ये तो गलत बात है।
नहीं मतलब सोचने का तो होता है लेकिन
हाँ, नहीं देखो जब आप इमेजिन करते हो ना इमीडिएट एक छवि आ जाती है, जैसे आप लिखते हो ना एकदम छवि आ जाती है, उस छवि को लिख दो बस, दैट्स ऑल देयर इज टू इट। आपको जैसे ज़बरदस्ती ये नहीं करना है कि सैनी ब्रिज पे आप जाके एक सीन लिख दो ताकि आपको दिखाना इलाहाबाद, ऐसा करने की ज़रूरत नहीं है। मतलब और जैसे आप जगह की बात करें ना, इट इज़ नॉट ज्योग्राफी ऑल्सो, इट इज़ ऑल्सो कल्चर। आपका बोलने का तरीका किस तरह का है, जैसे मसान में हमने बोलने का तरीका काशी का रखा है जो वहाँ की लोकल बोली है, वहाँ की हिंदी अलग है, और जब वो लोग भोजपुरी बोलते हैं तो उसको भोजपुरी नहीं बोलते हैं, सो काशी का बोला जाता है। इलाहाबाद में थोड़ी सी अक्खड़ भाषा होती है, तो वहाँ का अगर आप फ्लेवर लाओगे, वहाँ के दो तीन चीज़ें जैसे बोली जाती हैं जिस तरह की तकिया कलाम है, तो वो आप लाएंगे तो वो एक फ्लेवर ऐड करता है लोकेशन का। फूड, फिर आपकी भाषा हो गई, और पहनावा हो गया, पहनावे में कैसे कैसे लोग पहनते हैं, कुछ चीज़ें बहुत ही, तो इस चीज़ की ना हम लोग जैसे करते हैं तो बहुत सारा रिसर्च होता है। तो मैं चाहता हूँ अगर आप लिख रहे हैं तो आप एक बार जाइए वहाँ जाके इन सारे, क्योंकि हम लोग इतने पले बढ़े हैं ना, जैसे आप इलाहाबाद में पले बढ़े हैं तो आपने कभी इस चीज़ को गौर नहीं किया होगा कि यार यहाँ पे तो ऐसा होता है वैसा होता है, क्योंकि आपके लिए तो ये रोज़मर्रा की चीज़ हो गई। तो आप एक बार दोबारा जाएँ और स्क्रिप्ट को उस तरीके से महसूस करेंगे ना तो आपको बहुत रस मिलेगा।
थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू सर।
I think with the vast amount of talent on stage on either side, this conversation can go on and on forever. But thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us. And thank you very much to both the gentlemen here, Mr. Prakash and Mr. Neeraj Ghaywan, for taking time off and coming here. Thank you.